A key component of any data pipeline is extracting and loading data from a source system into some sort of landing area. And there are many well-known products that focus just on this particular concept, but the reality is each of these does come with a cost, and they're typically billed on usage, which can get really expensive, especially if you have a lot of data. But fortunately, the open source community has come forward with a great new tool called Airbyte. And Airbyte, as we said, is an open source tool. It's an open source data integration tool that plugs right into any ELT pipeline that you're trying to build or one that you already have. And while there are some limitations compared to these other products that are the paid products, I'd say in general, Airbyte is really powerful and is going to be sufficient for most of your use cases. They do also have a cloud hosted option that you can pay for if you don't want to deal with that hassle of setting up that open source infrastructure yourself. But I don't want you to have to pay for that if you don't have to. So today I'm going to walk you through step-by-step how to get that free open source version of Airbyte up and running on your machine and start syncing data to a database server. This video is going to cover a lot of topics like ELT, Snowflake, Docker. These are all things that are part of that modern data stack. So if you are new to this, or if you're just looking to learn more about that, I have put together a free guide. I call it the starter guide for the modern data stack, and it'll help you get a better idea kind of how this all works together. And I'll link that down below. Okay, without further ado, let's get started. The first thing we'll need to do is install Docker, and Docker allows you to create containers on either your machine or you could host this in the cloud somewhere. It's slightly different than a virtual machine where you have different operating systems on each one. Instead, it allows you to use one host operating system and create multiple apps. Airbyte in this case is an app, so that's what we're gonna do. So let's get started. We're gonna install Docker desktop right on our local machine in this case. So I'm gonna go through the steps of installing this and let's open it up. Here we can see the Docker desktop interface with containers, images, volumes. We're not gonna cover that here, but let's just go through this simple get started just to prove that Docker works. Again, this is not a Docker tutorial. It's more just to show you that this is set up. So we'll copy and paste this command now that it's installed. It pulled down that image, it created a container, and now we can see that it's there. So if we go ahead and open this on our local browser, here it is. This is essentially like an example of one of those apps, but it's just the getting started app for Docker. Again, not gonna get into the specifics of all of this stuff. All we're trying to prove here is that we have Docker installed, it works, and now we can do the next thing, which is setting up Airbyte through Docker. So now let's go to the Airbyte site. We're gonna do this open source. Then here again, it says step one is install Docker, and then we can just run these commands to spin it up. So we'll go ahead and paste this in. The first thing it's gonna do is clone that Airbyte repo. So we'll get that on our local machine and change into that directory. And once that's done, we'll run Docker compose up and it's gonna spin it up for us, as simple as that. And here it is. So Airbyte is now installed, running in a container on Docker on our machine. Again, this is our local machine, but let's now go to this site. And here it is. We're able to access the Airbyte interface just like that. As soon as you have Docker, it's as easy as just running these commands. We'll add some information here, our email. And we can also see down here that it says it's on an alpha version. That is something to consider here with Airbyte. If you're going to use it in production, understand kind of where it's at in its development cycle. So we'll go through and set up our first connection. We're going to do a Google Sheet connection, something very simple here. And for any source you pick, there are different directions here that you can follow. And in this, something to point out here with the Google Sheets is that if you're going to replicate multiple sheets, which I'm sure would be very common, you need multiple connections for each. So it's for each Google Sheet. The first thing we need to do is set up an API connection to allow Airbyte to get through. So in my case, I already have a Google Cloud account, so it's a little easier. You may need to set this up on your end if you're using Google Sheets. We'll select this option up here to add the Google Sheets API to our API library, and we'll go through here. And now let's just enable this. Okay, so we're all set up here. We have this API ready to go, but we need to put some credentials in here. So I'll select create credentials and we'll go through this wizard here. All right, so now we're gonna set up the service account details, create and continue. Now we can add a role. For our sake here, I'm just gonna do basic editor. We want it to be able to read, update, create whatever we want from Google Sheets. So we'll select that option and continue. Now, which users do we want to have access to? I'm the only user on this account, so I'll put myself in for both of these and continue. So now we have our Google Sheets API set up, ready to go, and we can use this within Airbyte to do what we need to do. And we can see there's a specific email in here, and this is important for us, particularly for Google Sheets, because we're going to need to share this with this account, as we'll see in a minute. But the next step here is we need to create a key. We need to create a new key, and it needs to be this JSON value. Again, this is all specific to Google Sheets. This may be different for you, but I think Google Sheets is a common example. And here we can see here, it's asking for that JSON key. So I'm going to go ahead and create that, and it'll save it to my local machine. I'm going to hide this, and I'm going to open this up off of the screen so you can't see it, but I am going to copy this value, and now I'll paste it in here. Next, we need to determine which spreadsheet we're going to link to. So in our case, we're doing this Google Sheet. It's called TechStore. I have two that we're going to use. So first is TechStore, and it has three tabs within it. But you'll see here, as soon as we go and we try to link this, it's going to give us an error. And that's because we have to share this with that email, as I mentioned before. So we have to go back and go to our service account and grab this email, copy this, and we're going to share our sheet with the email. So paste that email address in there, share, and that should give it the correct permissions that it needs. So if we go back and try this again, now that API should be able to get through via the email, and we're all set. So now that passed, the next thing we need to do is set up our destination, which in my case is Snowflake. We're going to move this data from Google Sheets to Snowflake. So if we go through the destinations, we can see there's a ton of options, but I'm going to pick Snowflake. And there are some prerequisites here. This is similar to a lot of other tools where it's best practice to create a specific user, database, etc. But it also mentions that in terms of Snowflake specifically, you can also add some configurations based on your loading method. If you're doing a storage bucket or, you know, different stages, again, kind of specific to Snowflake. But in our case, we're going to keep it very simple. We also need to have account admin permissions. So if you don't have that, you'll have to ask somebody else to help you out here. But what we're going to do is copy and paste all of this here. It's nice that they print this all out for us. So let's copy. I'm going to switch to account admin. Again, you're going to need this permission to do any of this stuff, because we're making a kind of account and larger database level permission changes here. And we'll paste this in. And what we can see here is it's filling this out for us, the different users' roles. But what we do need to determine is a password. So I'm going to use LastPass to generate a nice secure password and set that value there. But we can see here it's setting those different warehouses, schemas, et cetera. And as you go through the rest of the query, it's using those values to create these new objects for us. And we're going to grant ownership, all this stuff. So as long as you fill out those top portions, you have account admin permissions, you can just go and run this. It's going to do all this for you and create something specific to Airbyte that your database server, Snowflake in our case, can use. And we can see it created the database, it created the schema. So now we're ready for Airbyte to start loading data into Snowflake. So let's go back and we'll go through and finish filling out this information. The first thing we need is the account or the host name, which is the URL. We can get rid of the HTTPS. And then the role, warehouse, all this stuff. We use the defaults. So I'm just going to go through and add these default values in here for us. And what we're going to do is a username and password. We set that password for the user. We'll copy this and just have it connect directly this way. We're not adding any parameters. And the loading method, like we said, there are different options for different stages in Snowflake, but we're just going to use the default internal stage to get this going. All right, so let's go ahead and set up destination and let this do its thing. It looks like there's an extra backslash at the end of the URL. So I'm going to go up here and delete that from the host and try this again. And this time we're all good. So now we can set up the official connection between them to move the data around. And here is another form to fill out. We'll give it a name. We can determine the frequency that it's going to replicate. Every 24 hours, every 5 minutes, whatever you want. We'll call this Google Sheets Tech Store to Snowflake. Call this whatever you want. but this will be unique to this particular sync or connection. I'm going to set this to manual. Now the destination namespace, you can do different options. We'll see two. The first time we go through this, we'll just keep the default mirror source structure. And we'll see what that looks like then when it deploys. And the prefix is something that you can add to each table if you want. So if you're keeping this in the default namespace, for example, everything's going to fall under the Airbyte database. But if you do the prefix, let's say tech underscore store with two underscores, every table within this will have that prefix, and you can kind of organize your data coming through that way. And we'll see what this looks like. But again, here are each of the three tabs within our individual Google sheet that we're working with in this example. Now, the last option here is the normalization and transformation. This has to do with the way the data is sent over. You know, by default, it's kind of sent over almost like an API where it's all JSON data, but instead you can have it normalized as a tabular data so that it looks like a table when you see it and it makes more sense. And we'll see what this looks like here. So let's go ahead and set this up, and it's going to start our syncing for us. And we can click this link and see the progress. We can see the history of this connection. We're now in the connections tab, and we can see the status, the time, individual logs. So it's very clear. Now, if we go to Snowflake, we can see it's already setting up the landing location for the raw data. And in this case, that raw data is that JSON only data. It's not the normalized tabular data, as we'll see later. But again, we can click around here and see different things. And just a reminder, again, all this is happening on our local machine. We're using this whole thing through a Docker container on our local machine, and we're getting all of this to work. So now this is done. Let's go ahead and skip through this. It should be complete. And if we go back and refresh under our schema, we can see not only the raw data, which is that JSON data, but we can see our individual tables are there. So if we look at our main tables, this is what that tabular format looks like. This is what we want it to look like in this case. And we can see all of our data was moved over along with some additional Airbyte metadata like IDs, timestamps, etc. So let's change this now to show you another example. Instead of the default namespace, let's do a custom format. Let's say we want this to go in a completely separate schema called tech store. And in this case, we won't need the specific prefixes, but let's say in this case, we want every source to be its own schema. I think that's a common scenario. So we'll go ahead and update this, and it's going to go through and refresh all of this. But I want to show you the difference between mirroring and custom. Eventually it did come through and complete. Let's refresh. And now we can see there's a specific schema now called tech store with our data there. So you can see the difference. Instead of having it all under one schema called Airbyte schema, instead we can have it in its own schema and maybe not use the prefixes. It's up to you what you prefer to do. So let's go through and drop this, refresh. And now we're left with just that schema. Now let's do this again with a different sheet. And this time it's payment data, just another sheet. And what we're gonna do is go through the same steps. We know we need to share this with our service account. You know, once these basics are set up, this can get pretty quick. So we've shared this. It now has access. The API service account has access to our new sheet. So we'll go through and we'll create a new one. We'll do Google Sheets. And this time, instead of calling it Tech Store, let's call it Payment App, just to differentiate between the two, and copy that service account JSON, the same one as before. And now I'm also going to copy the link to this spreadsheet. So everything should be connected if we did this right. So let's go ahead and add this in here and select setup source, and it's going to try to connect. And now that was successful as well. So we can move forward. Let's set up a destination. We'll add it to Snowflake, which already exists. We don't have to change anything here. We can just automatically connect it. We'll give this a name. And this time again, we'll call this payment app instead of tech store, just to again, differentiate between the two. We'll say this is a manual run, and we'll do a custom format. Remember how we just did that before, but this time we'll call this payment app so we can have this loaded to a separate payment app schema in Snowflake here. So we'll have all of it within this database. Now in this scenario, I actually have a few hidden tabs that we don't need. We only want one called transactions. So I'm gonna unselect these. We only want the transactions sheet to be going through with us. Okay, so that's set. This time what we'll do, just to, again, to show you, let's do just raw data, JSON. And now it's gonna go through and sync. And if we go in here, it's now loaded very quickly, but this is what it looks like with just the JSON data. Let's go back to the schema here. The actual schema that we're looking at, the underlying sheet has three columns. It has date, ID, and payload. Instead of being flattened out, it just puts it all as a single JSON object. But let's say we want each of those to have their own columns. We don't want it to be that JSON. We can go back here and update this back to normalized. See, now there's a new table called just transactions that has those values flattened for us. This payload value is already a JSON, so that's expected. But now we have payment app, text store, Airbyte schema still exists because we still have this configured as the default in our Snowflake connection in Airbyte. But let's say we were to get rid of that, and you know, we can see now this is kind of what it would look like. But if we go back to Snowflake, I can show you where this is happening. It's right here. So we have the default database, the default schema, all of this. We could have changed this if we wanted. So you can determine the naming conventions that work best for you. But then you have Airbyte set up to load data, possibly in individual schemas or all in one schema, however you want to work for you. And all of this, again, is done hosted as an open source tool, either locally or maybe on a cloud service as a container. And the nice thing about setting it up this way also is we created a warehouse specifically for Airbyte, so we can see exactly how much is being charged for this processing. And if you're using the open source tool, this is really the main cost that you're gonna have. So at this point, our connections are all set up and we can start adding more, do whatever we want, and use Airbyte to its full potential. This is just the beginning of things you can do with Airbyte, which is pretty amazing considering it is open source. I hope you found this helpful, and let me know what you think about Airbyte or what your experience has been. As a reminder, if you're new to the modern stack, take your first step in putting the pieces together by grabbing a copy of my starter guide for the modern stack, link below. I think it'll be really helpful for you. And thanks as always for watching, and I'll see you next week.